I was a frustrated filmmaker, a frustrated feature filmmaker. I wanted to be and make movies. So no one would give me money to make anything longer than 4 minutes. So I went, okay, I'll make 4 minute long movies. Woman, you want me, give me a sign. And catch my breathing even closer behind.
Russell was one of the great music video directors that emerged from that period as a director that could see how the result of a great music track combined to interesting, glamorous visuals with the right artist could create something that was more than the sum of the parts.
Simon and I liked it because we had that. We were a bit more kind of adventurous, and we liked traveling. We liked going to slightly weird places. I didn't think Nick liked the idea very much because he still liked wearing makeup and stuff. So for him, going to Sri Lanka and staying in a, you know, a dodgy old hotel somewhere was not something he wanted to do, I don't think.
I got there completely fried, having not slept for 2 or 3 days, and I arrived in Sri Lanka thinking, OK, record's done, I'm going to take it and play it to everyone else. Let's hope they're happy. I got off, came out from the plane, I think, well, OK, where's the guy with my limo? So I was looking around, and an Indian guy comes over to me. He said, Nick? I said, yeah, yeah. I said, well, where's the car? He said, oh, it's over here. So we go out, and it's, I mean, blistering heat, and I'm dressed from head to toe in black leather. So, wow, okay, well, let's get in the car. Perhaps there'll be some air conditioning. Anyway, it's a flatbed truck. So, oh, my God. I said, well, how long is it to the hotel? Expecting him to say 20 minutes. He said, 5 hours.
Nick is the most urbane member of Duran Duran. Was then and is still now. The most difficult to get out of the city.
So we drive for 5 hours over these dust tracks all the way into God knows where in Sri Lanka. And we end up there, and literally as I arrive, somebody gets my bag and takes it up to the hotel, and I'm walking down to the beach where they're filming in a complete daze, and an elephant walked past me on the street. I was on my own. I thought I was hallucinating.
It was so much fun doing those. We worked so hard. We'd get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and we'd go to bed at 11 o'clock at night, and we'd work all day long in between. And we were totally, totally, totally exhausted by the end of our 5 days there.
But it kind of worked. You know, it was kind of so, it was one of the, this is so crazy. You know, we've got these guys in eyeliner and crazy color hair, and they're on the back of elephants. It was so bizarre, but it, you know, it was kind of irresistible.
We came back with 3 whole videos.
Hungry Like the Wolf was actually written with the Jupiter 8, which is the synthesizer I used for much of the sound on the Rio album. It was sort of new out around that time, about 1982, and I completely fell in love with it. Simon and I think, had been out the night before, and we the most terrible hangover, and for some reason we're feeling guilty about it and decided to go and do some work. So we went to EMI Studios at Manchester Square, and we got in quite early, and we'd been listening to something in the car, and we got a sort of idea, and I started playing with this sound. It won't sound quite the same, I shouldn't think, because it needs effects, but... Simon had an idea for a lyric, and by lunchtime, when everyone else turned up, we pretty much had the song. And Andy came in and played a killer guitar riff on top of it, and John and Roger thought, this is easy.
Well, that's pretty hooky already, isn't it, though? And then you got Andy's angry guitars. It's really Andy that gave the band that real edge. And Andy was pretty... He's from Newcastle, so he had this edge to him.
Later, Roger added the Simmons drums, and suddenly it sounded like nothing else we'd ever heard.
It's got these great big fills in, which was this amazing new kit. It's like a hexagonal drum kit. But there's only really two sounds on there. You had this sound. There we go, which is really cool. Very new sound then. And it had a really kind of pingy disco-y sound as well, which nobody used. But this was one of the drum sounds of the 80s, was this drum. But there's a big roll coming up. There we go. One of Colin's things, he always had had a lot of ambience on the record. You know, we record the drums very tightly, as you can hear here. Very tight drum sound, but then he'd add this ambience. There you go, that's with the ambience. And that kind of defined the drum sound for the 80s in a way. You'd have this kind of gated ambience. If you've listened to In the Air Tonight, Phil Collins, it's got this drum sound that's it's got this beautiful ambient sound on it. And that was how Colin liked to record. It was this combination of tightly recorded stuff and big ambient mics that gave it that really powerful movement.
I remember interviewing them after the album, after Rio had come out, when they'd just come back from a really grueling 2.5 month tour supporting Blondie in the States and Canada. And they were absolutely exhausted. And obviously this is all part of how you broke America.
The band had this very effeminate image in the US at the time. It was quite tricky selling a new romantic movement with makeup, etc., to an American audience, especially in the Midwest.
There was always this issue in the US about whether you needed to remix certain parts of an album or a single or a song to fit, in quotes, the American marketplace, the American club scene. And I had met a producer called David Kirschenbaum.
Well, the first thing that struck me were the chord progressions. The melody and the chord progressions were different than what was going on in American music at the time. And that was captured by some really infectious rhythm.
And I had introduced him to, I think, Paul Barrow, with a view that maybe Paul would want to consider him to help in remixing some parts of the album so that it would give a kind of more of a, in quotes, an American feel or an American mix to some of that music.
And that's really what we were kind of aiming at, is getting Simon's voice correctly out in front, but yet surrounding it with the right rhythm elements that would bring it forward. And I was taken by the sound. I thought it was something that could definitely work.
So yes, we sold our soul, and we remixed the album with David, who did a very good job.
But then there was this whole new other avenue, MTV.
When we were starting out, what we wanted to do was bring together the two greatest cultural forces in America for the baby boomers. One was rock and roll music, and the other one was television.
A music channel where they were going to play nothing but videos. This was a revolution.
Hungry Like the Wolf was picked up by MTV. They put us into high rotation.
One day, my associate, Tom Preston, and I, who were there at the beginning of MTV, out in Tulsa, Oklahoma, just doing anything we could to try to find a story about MTV having an impact on record sales.
And Capitol Records could see that in certain towns, for no apparent reason, Duran was moving stock.
A clerk scratched his head and say, yeah, I'm selling Duran Duran and the Buggles. And I don't know why, because they're not getting played, but I just sold 3 boxes in Tulsa, and that's a lot of records.
And it almost came down to being as absurd of, on one side of the road where they had cable, where MTV was being piped in, that side of the road were Duran fans, and on the other side of the road where MTV didn't exist, or the cable, there wouldn't be fans.
We developed a great relationship with MTV. You know, they were hungry for videos at that point, because you had people that wouldn't make videos. I mean, some of the kind of more credible rock people were, you know, really backed away from it. They thought it was going to ruin music. They thought it was the end of music. Because you're lonely in your nightmare at the end. Because there's heat beneath your window, let me in. And there's silence on your stone.